Scary Enemies, an Amazing Level Generation, a Lantern, and more. I spent a lot of time working on my horror game over the last month. Oh, you are new and don't know what my horror game is? You should definitely check out my previous video if you want to know what it's all about. So, if you watched the previous devlog, you might know that the video ended with the game having quite a lot of bugs and problems. Most importantly, my implementation of a flashlight that points at the mouse cursor was not working at all, and it also broke the player animations. As you can see, the player is rotating slightly, which is not supposed to happen. Why doesn't the flashlight point at the mouse cursor properly? That's because I am using inverse kinematics to animate the player, and apparently this has an impact on the arm's rotation. I tried multiple solutions to fix this problem, for example duplicating the arm and deleting all the animation components from it so it's used for the flashlight only. I encountered lots of different bugs while trying to find the right solution, but no matter what I tried, it never worked out. After some hours, yes, I spent literal hours on that problem, I was exactly at the point where I started, just that now the player's arm didn't rotate at all. So I spent another massive amount of time trying to finally delete this problem from my game, but again I did not succeed. So what did I do in the end? I literally deleted the problem from my game. I got rid of the entire idea of an arm that points at the mouse cursor and replaced the flashlight with a lantern. A lantern lights up multiple directions at the same time, so it doesn't really matter in what direction it points. Damn, I'm so smart. But the removal of the flashlight created another problem. You might underestimate how much of an impact this has on the gameplay. You were able to turn the flashlight on and off, and you could point it into any direction you wanted, which added quite a lot of variation to the gameplay. But now you can do nothing with the lantern. You can't control it in any way. You can't even turn it on and off, because that's not how a lantern works. All you can do is pick it up and place it down, and that is boring, very boring. So I had to come up with a way to get the gameplay variation which we lost with the flashlight back. What I did was giving the player the ability to adjust the intensity and the range of the lantern, because that's totally how a lantern works. This gives the player more choices to make regarding the lantern and therefore brings back the gameplay variation. Because the enemies in the game will react to different kinds of light sources in different ways, the decisions the player makes regarding the lantern's range will have a huge impact on the player's success or fail in a round. I also added a maximum and minimum value for the intensity, because you were able to create a literal sun around the player or even a black hole. I didn't even know you could make negative lighting in Unity. I also added a bar that indicates how much light you have left in your lantern. Your light value will decrease faster when you use a higher intensity. When you run out of light, your lantern will turn off. The lantern on the ground also tells you how much light it has left. The original point of the lantern was to replace the flashlight, so I could have moved on to the next problem now. But I enjoyed making the lantern item so much that I added more details which I can also use for future items. I added an option to choose whether the player can run or not while holding the item, as well as a speed multiplier. I can change these values for the lantern item but also for all the items I add later on. With the new lantern item, we finally fixed one of the two problems from last devlog. The second problem were the weirdly broken player animations. As you can see, when the player stands still, he is rotating back and forth slightly. So all I did was simply remake the idle animation and we are all good. Moving on, what we need is a decent map generation, because as I said in the last devlog, the goal of the game will be to get as far as possible on a randomly generated path without dying. Kinda. So, what we have to do is make a randomly generated path. Just a path won't be enough. I want an environment with structures to explore and items to pick up around the path. So instead of making only a path generation, I had to make something more similar to a room generation. Each room contains the path, of course, as well as objects and structures around it to explore. I also wanted some rooms to have puzzles the player has to solve in order to progress further. So I made a pretty simple room generation, and this is how it looks like. I can choose the number of rooms I want to spawn, and the game will generate an accordingly long path. How does it work? We have a starting room that has a spawn point a little bit above it. A random room spawns on that spawn point when the game starts. The path in this room can go straight, right or left. Depending on the direction in which the path in this room leads is also the next spawn point. Only rooms with a left, right or upwards leading path can spawn after a room with an upwards leading path. And only rooms with an upwards or sideways leading path can spawn after a room with a sideways leading path. How did I handle the amount of generated rooms? I assign an ID to each room. The starting room has an ID of 0. Every spawned room gets an ID that is one number larger than the previous room's ID. If the next room's ID is going to be greater than my selected maximum amount of rooms, this room simply doesn't spawn and the room generation ends. This is a pretty basic and repetitive way to generate a level for a game, so I had to add more details to it. My idea? Special rooms with puzzles or bosses, or special rooms without any danger, where the player can chill or explore some unique structures for a bit. Making this was very easy as well. My plan was to assign numbers for special rooms, puzzle rooms and boss rooms to the room generator. What does this mean? Whenever one of these numbers is a factor of the next room's ID, the next room is going to be a special room, a puzzle room or a boss room. Whenever this happens, I simply spawn a normal room, but I also spawn unique objects inside of this room. For example, structures needed for a puzzle or a special environment needed for a boss fight. Right now I don't have any puzzle or boss fight related objects I could spawn, so I just took our lanterns to help out. One lantern stands for one special object. Four of these will spawn in every special room. Two lanterns represent a puzzle object and a total of eight lanterns will spawn in each puzzle room. Three lanterns next to each other represent one boss fight object, so 12 lanterns will spawn in every boss room. When I set the desired amount of rooms to 50, my factors to 5 for special rooms, 10 for puzzle rooms and 25 for boss rooms, you can find 4 lanterns in every 5th room, except for every 10 rooms where you can find 8 lanterns because these rooms are puzzle rooms. You can find 12 lanterns in room 25 and room 50 because these are the boss rooms. It works just great. I know this might have been a bit hard to understand, but I gave my best trying to explain it using my amazing English knowledge and a great visualization. But now, let's move on to something even cooler than level generation. I finally made the first hostile entities for the game. You will find out what these two enemies are doing exactly, but let's start from the beginning. When I started sketching out the first enemies, I messed up pretty bad. You can see the sprites here. I never assembled them because I, luckily, realized that they sucked very bad. Why? Look at the player model. It looks almost the same, just that the enemies are darker. Who wants to play a horror game where the monsters look almost identical to the player? I still don't know what I was thinking when making these. Anyways, after this initial failure, I knew I had to come up with something unique and horrifying so people would actually play my game. I browsed horrifying monster images online for a while, collecting the most interesting ideas I came across. After that, I had much more knowledge regarding scary entities and the results were accordingly good. I mean, just look at that. This is the first enemy I made, a four-legged dark entity which was going to have the most basic behavior. I called him the Howler because I thought it sounded cool. This enemy was going to chase the player while avoiding lit up areas. I already introduced this enemy in the last devlog and here it is. I actually thought animating an entity with four legs would be very hard, because I never did something like this before. But it was surprisingly easy because I'm using inverse kinematics to animate the objects in my game. The only hard thing I had to do was coding the enemy's behavior. Wait, no. I barely had to do anything because we already made the basic enemy behaviors in the last devlog. So, making this weird cube wasn't a bad idea after all. But still, even though I barely had to do anything, I still messed up quite a lot of things. Now we have one enemy, but making only one enemy in this devlog would be a little bit lame, am I right? So I added another enemy. The enemy we just made doesn't chase the player into lit up areas, so the player can just camp there as long as they want. This would be too easy, so the next enemy prevents the player from staying in lit up areas for too long. It spawns right behind the player shortly after they went into a bright area, and if they don't leave the area quickly, they are dead. A new player will most likely die when they encounter this enemy for the first time, but when they encounter it a second time, they will have learned from their mistakes and survive, which brings the concept of my desired trial and error gameplay into the game nicely. I also want every enemy in my game to have a dark and mysterious name. This one was called the Ashen, which gives off a pretty eerie vibe. Oh, and just in case you care, making this enemy was easier than making the previous one, but I still had my problems with it. Now, we have an almost complete level generation, our two first enemies, we fix the broken flashlight by removing it, and we fix the broken player animations. So I think this is a perfect moment to end this video, because the game is in such a good state right now. In the next devlog I will implement cool puzzles and minigames, add more content to the level generation and introduce the basic story of the game. Maybe I will even add more enemies. So if you are interested in the future of this game, make sure to subscribe. Also make sure to leave a like and some nice feedback in the comments if you enjoyed watching. Have a great day or night, and see you next time.